Hello and welcome to Section 2, Episode 17 of the LUFC Fan Zone podcast. I'm Sam Isles.
And I'm Jack Ellis.
In each episode, we'll be talking to an ex-Leeds United player or manager about their time at the club.
All of our episodes can be found on our LUFC Fan Zone YouTube channel, as well as Spotify and Apple Podcast. And last episode was the first section of Episode 17 with Giuseppe Berluschi, where the former defender spoke to us about his reasonings for missing the away game to Charlton in 2015. As well as how he settled in at England and getting sent off in his debut in his only game under former head coach David Hockaday. Today is the second episode of our interview with Giuseppe, and in this section, he speaks about his final stages at the club, including his opinions on the abuse he received from Leeds fans, most notably in the final matches he played for the club at Harrogate Town and Guiseley pre-season in 2017. Once again, he is speaking with his interpreter Adriano from his current side, AC Monza. The following season, Leeds had another head coach, this time in Uwe Rosler. And however, less than 3 months, he was replaced by Steve Evans. How did you find Steve Evans as a head coach? Because he was known for being extremely aggressive in the dressing room, which was not all to the players' liking.
Una persona credo che possa essere aggressiva quando ti dice chiaramente cosa fare, e quindi poi diventare tra virgolette cattiva quando tu non lo fai. Quando una persona non ti dice cosa fare, non può pretendere solo di alzare la voce e urlare e pretendere che si vincano le partite se non c'è un piano gara.
So yeah, if there's a difference between someone who has something clear in mind and tells you what to do and he can tell it to you by shouting, but if a person tells you things shouting without any plans, any clear instructions, you can't pretend to win games.
Just by
screaming, like you don't win games just by screaming.
However, once again, Leeds' performance that season weren't the best, and it was reported that you might have left that season in January. However, you stayed at Leeds. Was that true? And if so, what made you stay at Leeds?
Sì, potevo tornare in Serie A a gennaio, ma sia io che Cellino abbiamo deciso di rifiutare la proposta e di restare. Anche sia a gennaio sia dopo il primo anno potevo tornare in Serie A. Mi è stato promesso che si costruiva una squadra competitiva e si metteva un allenatore all'altezza. E quindi ho deciso di rimanere. Poi a gennaio nella mia carriera non ho mai fatto un trasferimento perché non lo condivido e non è mai bello lasciare a metà una stagione. Quindi ho finito il secondo anno, ho deciso di finire la stagione e poi purtroppo non è andata come si voleva, ma anche il secondo anno non avevamo la struttura necessaria per poter lottare per vincere il campionato.
Yeah, actually I had the chance both after the first season and then in January to go back to Serie A and play, but both President Cellino and I decided that I should have stayed until the end of the season. Also because in my career I never had a transfer in the January window, mainly because I don't really find it right to leave a club in the middle of the season. And I also decided to stay in January because President Cellino made some promises that he would have built a great team with a great coach. But unfortunately, at the end of the second season, I left just because I thought there weren't really the conditions to build a competitive team in order to try and get promoted.
And in April, towards the end of that season, you made a couple of errors which led to penalties, which resulted in Leeds losing to both Rotherham, where you finished the game in goal, and QPR at Elland Road. Following those matches, head coach at the time, Steve Evans, dropped you from the starting 11 against Hull. And reportedly, when you found out that you would be on the bench that day before match, you walked off the training pitch at Thorpe Arch and left training early. What made you react like that to being dropped to the bench after a few poor performances?
No, è nata la mia prima bimba è nata in Inghilterra. E purtroppo ci sono stati dei problemi durante il parto e quindi sia le difficoltà calcistiche sia le difficoltà familiari, non avendo la possibilità di avere i nonni o comunque i genitori miei o di mia moglie a darci una mano e darci supporto, fare il primo figlio e avere problemi al parto e avere la moglie in difficoltà e non esserci mai, perché il campionato e la championship inglese è davvero massacrante dal punto di vista fisico e mentale, perché si gioca ogni 3 giorni. In quel momento molto probabilmente avevo perso un po' il mio equilibrio interiore. Poi per quanto riguarda l'abbandono prima della fine dell'allenamento, perché mi aveva detto che c'era una partita sabato, mercoledì, infrasettimanale, nella partita infrasettimanale mi avrebbe fatto giocare, non mi ha fatto giocare, e quella è stata la goccia che ha fatto traboccare il vaso, ho deciso di andare via.
Yeah, so basically during that time my first daughter was born, and so obviously I had to deal with many emotions also, because my wife had some problems in the hospital while giving birth. So obviously we didn't have there weren't my parents, my wife's parents there helping us. So obviously it was quite a difficult moment, and I had to deal with a lot of emotions. And so it was not an easy time. And regarding the episode at the training ground, it was just because there was a game, a league game scheduled on Wednesday, and I had to play because Evans originally included me in the starting 11, but then he talked to me in the dressing room, telling me that I was included, I was part of the starting 11. And then when all of a sudden at the end he left me out, he excluded me from the starting 11, I just found it really disrespectful towards me, and that's why I decided to leave the training earlier.
Yeah, and as well as Thorpe Arch, you posted on Twitter about how Leeds' defensive record was better when you were in the team by using a spreadsheet comparing your stats to the other Leeds defenders at the time. What made you take to social media to vent your frustrations? Because that wasn't the only time you used your Twitter account, which am I right in saying you've deleted now, to show your feelings towards certain things that happened during your time at Leeds?
Perché era diventato una caccia all'uomo, un massacro personale. E nella mia vita e nella mia carriera ho sempre fatto parlare i numeri. Quando erano contro ho pagato, e in quel momento stavo pagando anche se erano favorevoli. Ho mancato di rispetto solo ai miei compagni. E basta, mi dispiace di quello che ho fatto solo per i miei compagni, ma dovevo tutelare me stesso uomo e me stesso calciatore.
So the only reason I did that is because at that time there were clearly some people that were against me and then wanted me out of the club, and obviously I had to show that despite my great performances, I was being left out. The only people I can say sorry to are my teammates. Maybe I disrespected them with that tweet, but I had to show the stats, because I felt that in that moment there were some people that were against me, and so I had to show the world, my fans, that I was actually performing well.
And it turned out that after that outbreak, you never played a competitive match for Leeds again. And not only did Steve Evans leave you out of the remaining 2 championship games for that 2015-16 season, but at the start of the next year, you left Leeds and joined Empoli on loan. But there you played almost every game that season, and there was a clause in the deal, a reported clause, that at the end of the year, you could have joined Empoli permanently, but they got relegated to Serie B. Is that the reason why you didn't join Empoli on a permanent basis, because of their relegation?
Yes.
Perché Cellino mi aveva pagato aveva pagato il cartellino e non voleva lasciarmi andare a diciamo a parametro zero. Avevo altri 2 anni di contratto e si è trovata la formula col prestito con diritto di riscatto in caso di salvezza. Purtroppo l'ultima partita siamo retrocessi e sono dovuto tornare all'inizio.
Yeah, so obviously since President Cellino had actually spent money for me, he didn't want me to leave as a free agent. So I still had the 2 years on my contract with Leeds, and so the right formula that the clubs found was the one of the loan with option to buy in case of avoiding relegation. Unfortunately, Empoli got relegated in the last game of the season, and that is the main reason why didn't stay at Empoli.
So you returned to Leeds with Thomas Christiansen as a new head coach, and you were one of the final Italian players still at Leeds from that huge influx in 2014. Did you believe that with a fresh start at Leeds, with a new head coach, that you could be pushed back into the team again? Or was it always your intention to leave at the start of that season?
Non potevo rimanere a Leeds perché faccio un passo indietro. Prima di andare a Empoli io non sarei andato via da perdente perché l'obiettivo era provare a vincere il campionato. 2 anni abbiamo fatto metà classifica, quindi sarei rimasto a disposizione un altro anno parlando con Cellino. Infatti io sono andato via gli ultimi giorni, cioè dopo l'inizio della preparazione del Leeds, dove non mi sono presentato alla preparazione, perché parlando con Cellino io avevo chiesto garanzie sulla squadra, sui giocatori, e garanzie soprattutto sull'allenatore, non tanto sui giocatori, sull'allenatore, garanzie sull'allenatore, che avrebbe dovuto mettere un allenatore di livello per poter competere o provare a competere, a lottare al titolo. E lui mi aveva promesso di sì, e invece non è stato fatto questo. Io non ritenevo giusto il comportamento che dopo la discussione che ho avuto con Cellino, durata anche parecchie ore, e quindi ho deciso di non iniziare la stagione con il Leeds e sono andato in prestito a Empoli. Quando sono tornato non c'erano i presupposti per poter rimanere, perché Cellino mi ha fatto accettato il prestito, quindi mi ha lasciato andare in prestito qualora io avevo altri 2 anni di contratto. Mi ha fatto 2 anni invece che 2 anni, mi ha fatto allungare di 4 anni il contratto e guadagnavo un quinto di quello che guadagnavo in quei 2 anni, quindi mi ha fatto guadagnare un quinto per 4 anni. Io sono andato in prestito. Con la retrocessione sono tornato a Leeds e mi restavano 3 anni a un quinto di quello che percepivo. Non c'erano i presupposti per poter rimanere.
So I'll just take a step back and I'm just gonna say that in my 2 years at Leeds, I had the ambition. I really wanted to achieve something important with that team, and I thought that we were gonna build something important in order to try and achieve promotion, and that had to start obviously by having an important coach, but obviously that never happened, and that is the main reason why in the summer I left Leeds in order to join Empoli alone. And basically when I came back to Leeds, there just weren't the right conditions to continue, because what happened is that before joining Empoli, I had I still had 2 years of contract remaining with Leeds. However, President Cellino, before joining Empoli, renewed my contract, and I had then 4 years, but they were the wage was split in those 4 years. So I earned less every year. So I basically earned what I used to earn in 2 years in 4 years. So obviously after the loan at Empoli, I came back and I still had 3 years with obviously a decreased wage. And I just there just weren't the conditions to keep going with Leeds.
And you did eventually leave Leeds in 2017 when you joined Palermo on a permanent transfer. However, before your departure, you did play some friendly matches before you left in that 2017-18 season. The first was against Harrogate Town and the second was against Guiseley. And during that match at Guiseley especially, you received some boos and abuse from some sections of the Leeds fans. How did that make you feel, that you were being booed and abused by your own supporters at that match?
Tristezza, delusione. Non ero riuscito a farmi comprendere, non ero riuscito a trasferire il mio essere, la mia etica, la mia idea, la mia sincerità. E quindi sono stato triste, amareggiato per tanto tempo e con le lacrime agli occhi ho chiesto a Victor Horta, direttore sportivo, di darmi una mano perché la mia avventura a Leeds era terminata.
I just felt really sad because I think that the fans didn't really understand me and the person I am, because I'm a person that always gives everything for the club I play for, and obviously it wasn't something nice. It made me sad, and in tears I asked for help to Victor Horta. Because I needed to change club.
Why do you feel you received the abuse you did at Guiseley, and did you feel that you deserved it from the Leeds supporters?
Perché in tanto tempo sono uscite molte notizie false dal bullismo con i più giovani, dalla rissa con Calvin Phillips, dalla rissa con Bamba nel parcheggio dello stadio. E tante tante altre cose, tutte categoricamente false. E quindi tanti rumors falsi e soprattutto tanti atteggiamenti miei sbagliati dovuti a una mancanza di rispetto e non a una lealtà ed un'onestà umana che è mancata da parte degli allenatori dell'epoca.
So basically the main reason was because of all the fake news that were going around at that time. For example, the apparent act of bullying towards some players of the youth team, the fight with Calvin Phillips, the fight with Bamba in the parking lot. All these are absolutely fake rumors, fake news, but obviously. I think that's what also influenced a bit the fans who booed me, and another reason could be my behavior towards the coaches, that at the end of the day didn't respect me. They didn't pay respect to me with their actions.
And if I asked you to sum up the Leeds United supporters now, what would you say about them? Because, like we've just touched on, they did give you some abuse towards the back end of your time at Leeds after you returned from Italy. However, prior to that, when you played for the club in the Championship, the fans would sell out every away match where you and Leeds played, wherever the side were in the table. And at the start of your career at Leeds, you did get a good reception from the crowd. However, things did turn sour towards the back end of your time at the club.
A me dispiace che non ho niente da dire contro i tifosi di Leeds. Io posso solo ringraziarli per l'amore che mi hanno dato nell'immediato. Sicuramente non ce l'ho con loro, perché li capisco e comprendo l'amore che hanno verso la squadra e verso il club. E mi dispiace solo che si sono fatti influenzare da voci non vere sul mio conto e non hanno provato mai a chiarire o a cercare la verità, e si sono basati solo su quello che usciva.
So I don't have anything negative to say about Leeds fans, and actually I want to thank them, because as you said, throughout my time at Leeds, they always supported the team 100%, always being side to side to the team. But the only thing that makes me sad is that they believed all those fake news. They just based their they just followed those fake news without trying to discover the actual truth. And this is probably the only thing that makes me sad. And I cannot say anything bad about that.
And then just days after that match at Geisley, it was confirmed that you had left Leeds on the permanent deal and returned back to Italy. How did it feel to leave Leeds after 3 years at the club, especially in the way that you treated in the final months at Leeds?
Oh, ero stato obbligato. Una sensazione non c'è stata né positiva né negativa. Subito dopo, anzi durante la partita, durante l'amichevole, ho capito che la mia avventura era giunta al termine. Quindi aspettavo solo il momento delle firme, aspettavo solo il momento di fare le valigie per poter andare via, sapevo. Avevo già capito tutto. Però se conoscono qualcuno, soprattutto dopo i 2 anni, chi ha fatto sia il primo anno che il secondo anno dei compagni, dei giocatori, se hanno un rapporto con qualcuno, possono chiedessero ai giocatori che tipo di ragazzo ero, che tipo di uomo ero. Sono un giocatore che dà tutto per il gruppo e dà tutto per il collettivo, sono un giocatore che quando c'era un terzo portiere anziano, che non ricordo il nome, mi dispiace, e Marfi, che dovevano andare via e si cambiavano in un altro spogliatoio. Io ho fatto la guerra con l'allenatore per farli restare in spogliatoio con noi fino al giorno che non andavano via. Sono un giocatore che per il collettivo e che per le cose giuste si butta nel fuoco e a volte ne paga le conseguenze, ed è questo il caso.
No, I actually didn't had any positive or negative feeling, mainly because I just felt that my time at Leeds was over, because I was forced to leave, and so I was just waiting it to be official, my transfer to Palermo, in order to leave. But if you ask any player that played with me in those 2 years, they can tell you what kind of man I am. I'm a man that always gave and gives 100% for the team, for the club. For example, I remember once there was the third keeper, quite old. I'm sorry, I can't remember the name. And Stuart Taylor.
Yes,
Stuart Taylor and Murphy, and they already knew that they were gonna leave, and the coach made them use another dressing room, and I just found that totally disrespectful, and I fought with the coach in order for them to stay with us until their last day at Leeds. So that shows how I am, like a man that always gives 100% for the team and for my teammates as well.
And how do you look back on your time at Leeds? Because for you, you could have seen it as a risk moving from Italy to Elland Road in 2014. However, how do you think it went for you? And do you think it was a success?
Assolutamente sì. Poi è nata anche mia figlia lì, al di là di tutto, per come è andato il parto, però. Sono diventato papà a Leeds e ho fatto un'esperienza bellissima, con una cultura diversa. E ho imparato il linguaggio calcistico inglese, anche se non l'inglese. E quindi ci sono anche gli aspetti positivi. Non è finita per come pensavo, non è andata per come pensavo, però è la vita.
No, at the end of the day, I'm actually really happy of the decision I had made. Also, mainly because my little daughter was born there, so I became dad in Leeds, and obviously this is something that made me really really happy. And I also learned the football terminology there in Leeds. And yeah, at the end, it didn't go as planned, and maybe it didn't. Everything didn't go as I wanted to, as I expected to, but I'm 100% happy of the decision I had made at the time.
And now, 3 years later, a lot has changed, and you're now at Monza, as we mentioned before, in Serie B, and also Leeds are now in the Premier League and having a very successful time since Marcelo Bielsa took charge of the club. But do you still follow Leeds and look out for their results, or is that era all in the past for you now?
Lo seguo, vado a vedere i risultati quando posso, che non giochiamo in contemporanea, se riesco vedo anche la partita, al di là che sono un appassionato di calcio, ma cerco di vedere anche gli allenatori forti, e Bielsa forse è uno dei più forti al mondo, e sono contentissimo per i tifosi, sono contentissimo per i miei compagni che ho avuto la fortuna di conoscerli sia come giocatori che come ragazzi, e da Phillips a Cooper a Dallas, Eiling, ci sono diversi compagni che ho conosciuto e sono veramente contento per loro, e soprattutto per i tifosi, che so quanto amore mettono e passione, ed è giusto che Leeds sia tornato dove merita con un grande allenatore.
Yeah, absolutely. Whenever I have the chance and we don't play simultaneously, I watch some of the Leeds games, as well as always keeping up to date by looking at the scores, and also because I'm a football fan in general, and I like watching coaches. So, and I personally think that Bielsa is one of the best coaches in the world right now. And because of that, I still follow Leeds, and also because I'm really happy for my former teammates Phillips, Cooper, Berardi, Dallas, Ayling, and I'm really happy for them and for the fans as well, because I know that the fans always give 100% for the team.
This final section of the show is where our followers get to ask their questions to our guest by commenting on our LUFC Fanzone Instagram post. Each episode, we select four questions which are commented and put them forward to our guest.
This week's first question comes from Carl, who asks, during your 3 years at Leeds, there were 7 head coaches: David Hockaday, Darko Milanic, Neil Redfern, Uwe Rosler, Steve Evans, Gary Monk, and finally Thomas Christiansen, some of which lasted longer than others. However, out of them 7 head coaches, which one did you learn the most from and why?
Tom non posso giudicarlo l'ultimo perché sono stato veramente poco tempo con lui, però credo che Milanic era l'allenatore più completo.
So I can't judge Tom the last one because obviously I was about to leave, but Milanic is definitely the coach who I learned the most from.
This week's second question comes from George, who asks, although it is unlikely because of the amount that's changed in the last 3 years, but if Leeds contacted you right now and said that they wanted to sign you and bring you back to Elland Road, would you be willing to play for the club again? And how would you feel about going back to Leeds?
Se si cancella la parte brutta, rimane sempre il pensiero iniziale. Quello non dipende da me.
So the fans should start a petition. No, but jokes apart, obviously if you take away all the negative period that I lived there for obvious reasons that I explained earlier, obviously I one day it could be nice to go back.
Next up is Matt, who asks, during your 3 years at the club, who was the best player you played with and why?
Phillips, perché era molto giovane e si notava una personalità, una sicurezza durante la partita di un trentenne. Quindi ero sicuro, già dal primo anno quando l'ho visto, ero sicuro che avrebbe fatto una carriera importantissima.
I think Phillips, because right from the beginning I could see, well, except obviously the technical qualities, but also a personality, the personality of a veteran, of a 30-year-old player. So right from the start, I could see that he could become a very important player.
And this week's last question comes from Luke, who asks, your time at Leeds was full of ups and downs. However, what was your highlight and your most memorable moment from your time at Leeds?
Al di là dei gol, dei due gol che ho fatto con Leeds e quell'azione d'aria aria con il chip sulla traversa, al di là di quello, credo che una figura e un'immagine racchiude quello che sono. Mi ricordo durante un riscaldamento a Ellen Road che provai un lancio uscito fuori di poco e prese un signore sulla carrozzina, e poi al termine della partita andai a donare la maglia per scusarmi, perché credo che questo racchiude un po' il mio modo di essere, il mio modo di vivere, cercando di aiutare sempre le persone che, tra virgolette, sono dietro di noi.
Yeah, so obviously a part of my goals, two goals at Leeds and my box-to-box run, one episode I remember with great joy is when one day during the warm-up at Ellen Road, I hit a fan on the wheelchair after a strike. And at the end of the match, I went to him and I gave him my shirt. And that made me happy at that moment, because obviously I always try to give everything for the fans and in order to make them happy as well. And I think at that moment giving the shirt to that guy made him really happy.
And that ends today's episode. Thank you to everyone for sending your questions, and thank you so much for your time, Giuseppe, and your perfect translation, Adriano.
Thank you.
We'll be back next week with another guest. Stay tuned for the post over on our LUFC Fan Zone Instagram later in the week. Thanks for listening.